We are celebrating Veterans Sunday next Sunday, so if you have a name to submit, please do so. This month is Bible month, that's why we are not putting up the Bible readings. And also, I would just like to give thanks to everybody for, I think I put it on the Friday Connect, for all your gifts, words, hugs, pats on the back, your cards for Pastor Appreciation Month. I really, really appreciate it. It's good to be encouraged. So I thank you for that, and also for your kindness toward my family. When you leave today, I'm going to invite you to go on one of these two exits, and we have this Bible reading plan. So when you leave, one per family, because we have a limited amount of plans. And so what it is, it gives you three options to read the Bible in a year. So it's pretty lengthy, because it tells you, you know, what you can do. And so we want to emphasize and we want to promote the Bible reading, the reading of Scripture. So please pick one up as you exit after church, one for family. And also, handbells will begin again next Wednesday at 6 p.m. And everyone is invited to come and pick up a bell. Even if you don't read music, I think that Tyler can tell you what to do and when to ring it. So the rest of the announcements are there before you. Anyone else have an announcement to make this morning?
Pastor Isaac.
Yes.
As the SPRC committee chair, I just wanted to, we got together and got the pastor a little something for this October, which was this past month for Pastor Appreciation, so we'd just like to give you this.
Thank you. I won't tell my wife about it. Let us listen to the prelude this morning.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Our call to worship is Psalm 107. Please rise. Oh, give thanks to the Lord who is good, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. The Lord has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west.
Some wandered in the desert wastes, finding no way to a city in which to dwell.
Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainting within them.
Then in their trouble, they cried to the Lord, who delivered them from their distress.
And led them by a straight way, till they reached the city in which to dwell.
Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind.
For the Lord satisfies those who are thirsty, and fills the hungry with good things.
Our hymn of praise is a mighty fortress, is our God. God, may we learn how to walk wisely from their examples of faith dedication, worship, and love. In the honor and noble victory of the martyrs, we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, through whom all things are possible. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus to allow us to come before your throne of grace. We have learned recently that personal prayer is the way to go. And how you listen to moans and groans in our heart, in our soul. Even the whimpers of a dying boy in the desert. Or a woman who cried before God. You heard them both. You're not looking for the right words. A poem of a prayer. Just we trust you. This morning, Lord, we come to church trusting you. Because we know that you have set the table before us. And what is happening now is what you have prepared for us, that we might be nurtured, that we might be strengthened, that we might be consoled, that we might have our wounds healed, our sins forgiven. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up our petitions. We pray, Lord, for Jesus of Nazareth, I pray for Robbie Schneider. I'm reminded of that woman who was suffering for 12 years, hunched over. And she stretched forth her hand, touched the prayer shawl of Jesus, and instantly she was healed. And I believe, Lord, that your eyes are upon Jim and Sheldon and Robbie and Maggie and others here in our midst. And in the name of Jesus, pour out your power. Do something miraculous. Your children might know that there is power in the name of Jesus. That we don't just come to church just because, but because it's real. Lord, we pray for this entire congregation and its future. You are the answer. And finally, Lord, we pray for this country. Everyone is free to vote as he or she chooses. We just pray, Lord, that you would give us wisdom when we come to the voting box. We might choose something that will not benefit me, but benefit our country. We are yours anyhow, and we will continue to follow you no matter what. And in the name of Jesus, amen.
See, a day is coming for the Lord, when the plunder taken from you will be divided in your midst. For I will gather all the nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken, and the houses looted, and the women raped. Half the city shall go into exile, but the rest of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations, as when he fights on a day of battle. On that day, his feet shall stand on the Mount of Olives, which lies before Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall be split in two from east to west by a very wide valley, so that one half of the mount shall withdraw northward, and the other half southward. And you shall flee by the valley of the Lord's mountain. For the valley between the mountains shall reach to Azel, and you shall flee as you fled from the earthquake in the days of King Uzziah of Judah, when the Lord my God will come, and all the holy ones with him. On that day there shall not be either cold or frost. There shall be continuous day, as is known to the Lord, not day and not night, for at evening time there shall be light. On that day, living water shall flow out from Jerusalem, half of them to the eastern sea, and half of them to the western sea. It shall continue in summer as in winter. And the Lord will become king over all the earth. On that day the Lord will be one, and his name one. The whole land shall be turned into a plain from Gibeah to Rimmon, south of Jerusalem. But Jerusalem shall remain aloft on its site, from the gate of Benjamin to the place of the former gate, to the corner gate, and from the tower of Hananel to the king's wine presses. And it shall be inhabited, for never again shall it be doomed to destruction. Jerusalem shall abide in security. This shall be the plague with which the Lord will strike. Let's stop there. I'll go a little bit further. I get carried away. It's really good. Okay. The New Testament reading. It comes from Acts chapter 2, verses 16 through 21. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams, even upon my slaves, both men and women. In those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you.
Sometime this week, I received a message on Facebook. They were sharing a video, actually. And I think it's called the Shut Up Challenge. The Shut Up Challenge, if I'm not mistaken. And what it is that they have the camera running, and so it's focused on the father. And so the mom is, they're all in on it except the father. And so the mom calls out to the son, says, "Hey, so-and-so, don't forget to throw out the trash." And you can hear the son's response, "Shut up, mom, and leave me alone." And so there's a dad watching TV. You know, and so there's several episodes, and some of them just jump up and go over, jump over the couch and run after the kid, right? And so they're trying to stop him. That's a humorous way of presenting what I want to say today from the Word of God. One of these days, God is going to stand up and get off his throne. And the prophet says so much, and it's not going to be a good day. It's called the Day of the Lord. And every November since I've been here, I turn to the coming of the Lord, because the last Sunday of November is always Christ the King, or thereabouts. And this year, because it has five Sundays, the fourth Sunday is Christ the King. And that closes the Christian calendar. And then we start again with the coming of, with the first Sunday of Advent, the coming of Jesus, the birth of Jesus. So this morning I want to add to the salvation of Jesus Christ that I have been preaching about a few months ago. Then we went to the urgency of the Hebrews and how the book of Hebrews urges us to hold on to our faith. We talked about the core of the Christian faith, which is the three commandments of Jesus, remember? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. You shall love thy neighbor, and you shall love one another. The three commandments that Jesus actually emphasized. Last month, we talked about the need for personal prayer. And today, we want to add the importance of the Day of the Lord. What is happening in the world today and what is happening in America ought to convince you that we're on that path. You know, I don't know why the United Methodist Church has opted, as a rule, not to preach about the coming of the Lord. Go to any Pentecostal church. Interdenominational church, all kinds of other churches, they preach constantly about the coming of the Lord, right? But the United Methodist Church has a history of not preaching, at least in recent years, 50, 60, 70 years. But I am convinced, brothers and sisters, that this is an important topic. It is a matter of life and death. Because it's going to happen whether you like it or not, whether you're convinced or not, whether it becomes an ugly day or not, we're going to see it. Some of us are going to see it here. And I believe that we should be concerned about our children and our grandchildren. Because even if I were there, I was thinking about it today, yesterday. Even if I'm there standing next to my daughters the day of the coming of the Lord, I cannot do anything for them. I cannot protect them from what's going to happen. I need to instill in them their own faith in Jesus Christ so that they can stand on their own two feet. And if necessary, give their life for Jesus Christ. And the Lord will remember that. Look at what we're doing right now. I would venture to say that all these people that we will mention in our list this morning, there's a reason we call them saints, don't we? We call them saints because They believed in Jesus Christ. Didn't they? They died with their faith that the Lord is going to raise them up. Well, that's what it's about. That's what church is about. So this week, so this month, I want to talk about the day of the Lord. I'm going to talk about the day of judgment. And on the fourth Sunday, I will talk about the day of Christ. And to supplement these sermons, on Wednesday Bible study, we will be talking about Matthew 24, which has to do with the same thing. But I want to start off by saying this. Human history, world history, and even the history of the universe has to do with the kingdom of God. It was created to establish the kingdom of God, the everlasting kingdom of God among men and women. That is the purpose of our creation. There is no other purpose. That's why I said, if you remember, about a month or so ago, I said, you know, our founding documents say that we were, you know, we're endowed in head and spirit, rights for what? For the pursuit of happiness. What else? I'm like one of the candidates now. life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? But there's something greater than that, which is the kingdom of God. And we were created for the kingdom of God. And the role of the prophets and the prophecy is to announce the ways in which the Lord is bringing this to reality. And it includes the divine interventions that are kind of like corrections, like when you're on a plane, you can feel the little, right? And it corrects itself. Well, God intervenes every so often and says, okay, let's move this way, and let's move this way, let's stop this from going on. That's what we mean. But in short, the day of the Lord is the time when God will ultimately overcome all resistance to his kingdom. That's when he gets up off his throne. And he says, basically, that's enough. In the Bible, the day of the Lord appears 24 times from Isaiah to the book of Revelation. 24 times with different adjectives, like the day of the Lord of hosts, the great day of the Lord, the great and terrible day of the Lord, the great and notable day of the Lord. But 24 times. It speaks about the day of the Lord. But every single verse, every single one of these 24 verses is described in such language as this. Destruction, fierce anger, vengeance, trembling, fear, the sun will be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, there will be bitter crying, and the heavens and the earth will be shaken. This is not a good thing. Not a good thing. In fact, the last time that the day of the Lord appears is Revelation chapter 1. Because John the Apostle says, I was in the Spirit when? In the day of the Lord. And then from chapter 2, the chapter 19 of Revelation, it spells out everything that is going to happen. And if you know, if you've ever read the book of Revelation, you know it's not a pretty picture. A lot of people, a lot of scholars, a lot of professors interpret that, well, that's just symbolic language that, you know, the Roman Empire and, you know, this sort of thing. You better read your Bible correctly. Chapter 2 to 19 is a string of cataclysmic events upon the entire planet. Remember that book, The Late Great Planet Earth? It's a good book. Therefore, John is describing what the old prophets, Old Testament prophets also wrote about the same day of the Lord, the day of reckoning, for a world that has opposed his purpose of redemption. But I think we need to understand one thing. The nation of Israel is at the heart of it. It's the watch. It tells you the timetable. You see what's happening in Israel, and I'm not saying like today, I'm saying necessarily, but notice what has happened the last 100 years. Look at how Israel has developed and expanded and flourished and has fought wars and all this stuff happening. Just watch what's happening. And you can tell where we are. It's very interesting because one of the resources I used for today was a book called The Old Testament Theology by Gustav Oler, written in 1883, long before the creation of the State of Israel. The State of Israel did not come into being like 1917, and then after that in 1948. But this one, this written 100 years earlier or less, he believed that Israel had to be reestablished. But I want to say this about it. One reason that Israel must reappear is to also face the day of the Lord. Israel also, the people of Israel, must also face the judgment of God, because they too have resisted and opposed the kingdom of God, especially when it came to Jesus of Nazareth. So they too must answer for that. So the day of the Lord also has to do with Israel, and that is why when you look at Ezekiel 36 to 39, Psalm 84, and other passages in the Bible, when the whole world is ganged up against Israel, and they suffer, it's a bad day. But in the end, God himself appears, which is why we read Zechariah. God himself, Jesus himself, appears out of the sky just as he left. He's going to come back, and he's going to set his foot on the Mount of Olives from which he left. And the Mount of Olives, did you read what it said? What's going to happen? And the Dead Sea, which is the lowest place on earth, the Dead Sea, the salted sea, will turn to fresh water. So, at the same time, God will destroy the nations, not only for hating Israel, but for resisting Israel. Now Matthew 25 makes more sense, which we'll also talk about this month. Because the Bible says, Jesus talks about a parable. Remember? That the king sits down and he begins to review, pass judgment on the nations of the world. You know, read what it says. You know, we usually take it, you know, that Jesus said, since you didn't feed the hungry and clothe the naked and you didn't visit them in prison. We usually take it as just being about social work. But that's not what the parable says. The parable is about the King, Jesus, sitting and examining the nations and how the nations have treated Israel. That is what that parable is about. But we don't want to get on track. Finally, brothers and sisters, just last week, I was taking my daughter to work. And I had been thinking about this, so I asked her. I said, Yamihita, are you ready to face the coming of the Lord? Are you ready? I raised them with that in mind. I think because of my father. Resisting the kingdom of God is not a good thing. Because whether it's on earth or at the point of judgment, we must all give an account of our obedience or our resistance. to the kingdom of God. But brothers and sisters, this morning, what are you feeling in your heart? Are you angry? Are you upset? Are you nervous? Are you afraid? How do you feel? Because it shouldn't, you should not be horrendously fearful. Right? Why? Who can tell me?
Jesus loves us.
You have this, don't we? And I mean every first Sunday. This represents what happens in your heart, in your life, every day. Because you come to Jesus Christ and you ask for forgiveness. Lord, I know I failed. And the next day, I know I failed. Sometimes it's the same thing, isn't it? But what does he do? Does he, like my father used to, he takes you, embraces you. All right? I forgive you. You know, remember how you used to dust off your kids? You know, you dust them off and say, okay, pat them on the back, and they're off running. He does the same thing to us. That's what this means here. Finally, the Apostle Peter says, if you know that this is going to happen, if you know that the day of the Lord is coming, should we be living a lifestyle of godliness, looking for and hasting, what does that mean? Hurrying, doesn't it? Hasting unto the coming of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, come to the table. Not only today, every day. Make amends with God through the blood of Jesus Christ. And let us look forward and let us be confident as the day of the Lord approaches. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have failed to be your church.
We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your will. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy.
Forgive us.
Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
What are we supposed to do though?
That's the last thing.
I'm going to ask those people who are going to participate with the communion, please come forward. The choir will please come forward. My gracious Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ to remember the Last Supper. And you took it, Lord, you took the bread, and you broke it, and you shared the wine with them, and you gave a new meaning for them, which was beyond the Passover. And they understood the deeper significance of it. And today, Lord, as we also break bread and drink wine, we pray in the name of Jesus of Nazareth that you would be present. That your Holy Spirit might move our hearts, soften our hearts, and convict us, that we might repent and turn to you and run to you. Especially, Lord, as we have heard today, that the day of the Lord is nearing. Forgive us of our sins and trespasses. Lift us up with the power of the Holy Spirit, that we might live a godly life. So, Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Same night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and after he prayed, he broke it, and gave to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, he took the cup, and after he prayed, he gave to the disciples and said, "Take and drink. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of sin. This also in remembrance of me." Father, behold your children, your ministers, who are your grace upon them as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Gracious Father, pour out your blessing upon your children here. Let them go in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, as always, recently, let us sing our response to the offering. And you may bring your offering to the front, and then we will have our remembrance of the saints. And light a candle, and if not, we will light it for you. And then, as soon as we light the candle, we'll hear the bell. All right? Pauline Bosk. Catherine Mullins. David Lundgren. Rita Latola. Nellie Lundgren. Esther Blanco. Mike Montgomery. Ronnie Engel. Betty Harper. Henry Hodge. Wilbert Schneider. And Bradley Schneider. Bill Hogan. Lord, it's a solemn moment, and we give you thanks. We remember our brothers and sisters who have gone on this year. One day, Lord, we will be reunited with them. We pray, Lord, that we too might be worthy of honor for our faith in Jesus Christ. Bless all the families of this church. Bless the families of these saints. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand that we might sing our last hymn, For All the Saints. The presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Amen.